Peace, audience. For Yah, our righteousness, Jerusalem, and the Holy Seed. To our national audience, our international audience, peace. This is August 30th, 2010. First show we've done in about 16 months. That's okay. We've got a lot of things on the internet that I'm sure many of you have seen, and if many of you haven't, you can always go to Mark Sims' webpage and dial in Yah Righteousness, and the whole website will come up for Yah Righteousness. It's also Yah Righteousness Weebly.com. That's another site that's been set up. And you can always call, and I'm sure Mark will put the number up, but you know, 773-874-0325. Many things have been taking place over the last 16 months. Many of you are aware of, I'm sure, who are cognizant of what's going on in the world. And I know many of you out there, your situation has more than likely gotten more dire. So it's a few things right off the bat that I want to get out the way that people have been inquiring about over the last year and a half, couple years, and they wanted me, well, since the last show, and they wanted me to talk about it. It was something that even before the last show, but I didn't get a chance to get to it, so I'm going to get to it now. People wanted me to show the fringe, okay, and the ribbon of blue. The fringe comes down so all the way around the borders of that garment, and the ribbon of blue is over against the fringe, okay? As you can see there, over against the fringe, the ribbon of blue, all the way around, not just in the corners, but all the way around. You'll read about that in Numbers chapter 15, verse 38. You can go there and read about that fringe, what it, the purpose of it is, and the ribbon of blue over against the fringe. I also wanted to mention about this soy. If any of you gone into Mark's webpage, Mark Sims, M-A-R-C-S-I-M-S, and brought his page up, you can also dial in Dr. Whitaker, Scott Whitaker, and you'll see, bring up some of Mark's things that he's, interviews he's done with Dr. Whitaker about his book, Medicine, in which in his book he talks about soy. And this soy is an attack on the people. It is insidious, this soy. A lot of propaganda that's been put out that is just that, propaganda. Soy is not what it's been propagandized to be, a benefit. It is a detriment. It causes infertility, can cause diabetes, cancer. It inhibits one from absorbing zinc, calcium, and iron into the body. And it also can cause one's throat to narrow where it's hard to swallow. Okay? I've experienced the latter myself. So that's why I'm not just talking out, you know, from something just that I read. I've experienced that. And over the last like 3 months, we have ceased to deal with soy at all. We've taken all soy products out of our house, and the only soy that is consumable by human consumption is soy that has been fermented. And like I said, you can get bring up Dr. Whitaker's interviews with Mark Sims on Mark Sims' page, and he will talk about that. You can get his book and you can go into that even further. But stay away from the soy, and soy is in many, many products. You're gonna have to read labels very carefully to take out that soy. It's also called lecithin, okay? As an emulsifier in many things. I wanted to get that out there today. Now, the title of this show. Oh yeah, and one more thing before I forget. I don't deal with emails, okay? It's many emails that are sent to Yah Righteousness. I don't have time to deal with emails. It doesn't make sense to me, for the simple fact, to discuss this book and to get into this book and what's going on in this world, there's no way you can email that to somebody and you know, y'all can give them illumination through an email. All right? So that's why we put the number up, the telephone number, for people who can call. Okay, and if you call, you know, it's just like 53rd chapter Isaiah. What does it say at the back end of that 53rd chapter Isaiah? He shall pour out his soul unto death. That's running his mouth, and that's what I do. Okay? I talk. And that's where it has to be conveyed, this message, through word of mouth, and direct people to Yah, to his word, his righteousness, which is this book of remembrance, the so-called Old Testament. Okay, now today, the title of this show, and I'm probably, you know, I didn't intend on being able to do it because it's a lot. So it's probably going to be a part two. Mark said we're going to do two more shows after this one. And part two, I know I'm going to at least need another show to explain all this, what I'm going to deal with today. The title of this is Serpents and Cockatrices That Shall Not Be Charmed. You will read that in chapter 8, Jeremiah, Jeremiah, verse 17. Okay? And what Yah is talking about there, he's talking about the children of Israel would be scattered into the nations of the earth, where we would be bitten by serpents and cockatrices. Okay? So now, that symbolism, what is it talking about? Lies and deception. And these serpents and cockatrices are pervasive in the world. They've been pervasive in the world. And they are many, many, okay? I've talked in the past about the whole educational system, okay, that is controlled by the adversary, the Leviathan. The Leviathan. You will see that in Isaiah chapter 27, okay? And it's talking about the Leviathan in the midst of the sea. The Leviathan are these Illuminati, Edomite, Amalekite, international bankers. Okay? They are the Leviathan who have the dominion in the world today, as many are witnessing. If you didn't know it, I'm sure you witnessed it over the last few years. They just gave themselves $23.4 trillion stimulus. Just took everybody's money they could, okay, of these legal tender dollars. And this economy, the dollar's getting ready to crash. It can go any day now. Just be looking for it, okay? Most analysts say it's going to happen after these next elections in November. But you can be looking for it any day now. It's going to collapse. They're going to bring in the Amero. And this Leviathan, okay, whose strength lies in diversity. You'll see that in Daniel chapter 7. We've spoken on it in the past. Diversity is the strength of this fourth kingdom, okay? Divide and conquer, all right? And they've used this diversity from the heads of the nations of the earth, the people of the earth, all the way down to, you know, throughout all the nations of the earth and every people thereof, to divide and conquer. And they do it with all kind of ways. Like I said, educational, with religion, okay? They don't care what religion you're about, because our religions are wrong. As I said on the very first show we did in July 2006, all religions are wrong, because it all comes from the heart of a man or men. So they don't care if you're into religions and the different denominations of religions, okay? Because that just divides people that much more and pits people against one another. And as long as people are divided, they will never come together, and they will never contact with the Creator, because they're all caught up into man-made ideas, ideologies, okay? And this is the poison that these serpents have, and this Leviathan in chapter 27 Isaiah has disseminated into other serpents that he's created, okay? And the vipers, the cockatrices that have come from those. I mean, it comes all the way down to the littlest people, you know, the smallest people, the poorest people on earth, and it comes from the head all the way down, okay? And this is the poison that they disseminate, the lies and the deception through religions and educational systems. You know, for instance, just like they teach the people, as I was taught when I came through grammar school, that Christopher Columbus, whose name was Cristobal Colon, that he was an Italian and that he discovered America. But it was people here when he got here to this side of the world. So if it was people here, how did he discover it? And he wasn't an Italian, he was an Edomite, okay? A Jew. So these are lies and deceptions. Like we were told, Alexander the Great died of a fever, but he was poisoned. We know that, okay? We have an article here. We've spoken on it in the past. So all of these are lies and deceptions. Same thing with Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, Buddhism, Zoroastrianism, Scientology. All of these are lies and deception that is disseminated to the people to divide them, to conquer them, okay, to control them. Same thing with this thing that's used on the people here in America and other places, you know, this mindset of black and white, okay? I've never seen a white person. As you can see, this top I got on is white. I've never seen anybody look like this, all right? Just like many people would characterize me as black, but if you look at me, I'm brown. I'm not black, see? And these are lies and deception to keep people divided, okay? Even to divide people. Many people who are considered black are divided by this, okay? When they call it the high yellow, they use the term high yellow on some of us. They use the term black on some of us, okay? It's to divide us even, okay? And then this divisiveness is sinister. It's destructive. And if one looks at this logically, you will see that, okay? And this is what is steadily perpetuated on the people of the earth. Right now, we have this thing going on with the Tea Party. Okay, many people characterize it as a racist movement. We have the Glenn Beck's, okay, with their espousing their doctrine. Okay, divisiveness. Okay, you have your Rush Limbaugh, same thing. You have your Pat Robertson, same thing. You have your Louis Farrakhan, same thing. You never will hear Farrakhan basically give a speech where he calls himself a Muslim, okay? But he talks more. I've seen many of his shows. They show him here in Chicago, Illinois, every Monday. And I hear him, he talks more about the idol, one of the idols of Christianity, okay, this so-called Jesus, Yeshua. He uses the term Jesus. He talks about him more than he talks about his idol of Islam, Allah, all right? Divisiveness, all right? But you barely will ever hear him speak, and he does not mention black and white, okay? He's generally always going to say black and white, okay? And this is, again, divisiveness, all right? You have many other people, your Sharptons, okay? Your Jesse Jackson spreading lies and deception, okay? Many other people, Kralo Dollars, you know, T.D. Jakes, all of them, lies and deception. They are cockatrice, okay, vipers that spreading divisiveness and the lies and deception of the Leviathan, those who rule, okay? Some knowingly, the ones I just mentioned, knowingly, many, many others in our communities all around the world working for these, don't understand they're working for these people. Okay, basically they have hidden agendas. They have their own selfish reasons for why they do what they do. Okay, many of them get congregations of people that group up around them. Okay, and sustain them with offerings and tithes and donations and contributions, and they live off of that. Okay, so that's why they keep perpetuating the lies and the deception. But people are going to have to start to discern the truth. And the only way to do this, you have to go to this Book of Remembrance, this so-called Old Testament, Authorized King James Version. It's the best one. It's been tampered with too, but it's the best one because it will lead you to Yah. It's a treasure map. Yah has prepared it even through the Illuminati Edomite, okay? Unbeknownst to him, okay? Yah still had this book come out the way he wanted it, but he's got it to where you have to come to him in submission and commitment and obedience for him to illuminate you of this book. And if you don't do it, then you're going to be cut off, you're going to stay cut off, and you're not going to be able, as it says in Malachi chapter 3 at the end, to return to Yah and discern who is serving Yah and who is not serving Yah. And that's the time we live in now, and you don't have a lot of time to mull this over or to sit back and scrutinize this, because this whole situation in the world of economic destruction and plagues that are being brought on the earth and have been brought on the earth over the last, 10 years, okay, basically since the tech stock collapse, and it's been accelerated ever since. And ever since 2005, with the hurricanes that hit America and hit the Caribbean, you know, basically Katrina was what happened with that hurricane, and how it tore up New Orleans, and then, you understand, brought all this devastation. It has accelerated even from that point, as we see in Pakistan with the floods, 20 million people displaced, hundreds of thousands of people have lost their homes, and 20 million people displaced, they say, and thousands of people have died. They don't even know how many yet. Okay, you got floods in China. Thousands of people are dying there in that. Okay, homes are destroyed. All right, you have an intense heat that Yah is bringing in Russia, and he has brought this intense heat, and they don't know how many people have died from that. They said they've never had heat like this ever since man is knowledgeable of time itself, okay? I mean, this heat is so intense, it's causing the forest to just, trees to just break out and, into fire, just to burn up, okay? And I've seen this on the news, and probably many of you have too, okay? And this is Yah bringing his judgment on the inhabitants of the earth, okay? That's the 51st chapter of Isaiah. All right, he's making his judgment to rest for a light of the people. Because when people, long as it's, as the proverb says, prosperity, when prosperity comes, be joyful. But when adversity comes, consider. And this is how Yah is making the people of the world consider what is going on. Because as long as people have plenty of economic prowess, plenty of economic a substance to where they can buy and things that they need and want and do the things that they want to do, okay, they can't hear anything. It's when they start getting whipped, just like a child, all right? That's why at times you have to apply the rod to a child, because you're training, you're raising it to know the difference between right and wrong. And all the time verbal reprimand does not take, it does not take hold, all right? So you have to apply the rod, put a little fire on them to make them stop and consider and allow that light to come in. And it comes in with judgment. That's when people stop and consider, okay? When judgment comes. And this is why you have all these millions, 50 million people on food stamps. That's what they tell us. It might be 100 million. Getting food stamp subsidies because their dollars that they make from their, if they have a job, okay, is not enough to sustain them anymore, because we're living in a time of inflation, and the dollar's rapidly losing its buying power, okay, because it's getting ready to go out. So you have, through all of this economic collapse, plagues of weather and disease, okay, and that Yah is bringing on the earth, the drought and famine, this is what makes people stop and consider. Now, when you take into account all the things that's happening, one has to stop and really look and see what it is that they are doing that is bringing this devastation on themselves, okay? And like we've said in the past, now for close to a good 1800 years, you've had Christianity in the world, okay? For 1400 years, close to it, you've had Islam, okay? Hinduism, Buddhism, okay, they're probably a little earlier, some of them, and some of them a little later. But the point is, you have all these religions that people have been led into, raised into, coerced into, and look at the state of the world. Okay, I saw people from this Gulf oil spill that I know all of you have heard about, because it's all over the world, they're talking about it. The people in these areas on the shore of Alabama and Louisiana, I saw them here a couple of months ago, month and a half ago, they were, when the oil was still gushing out, just destroying that whole area down there. The fishing is all over with down there. Many of the people are homes of inundated with the toxic smell of the oil and the gases that came out from it, as well as the corexit, okay, that they sprayed over that area to the tune of 2 million gallons, and it's just unbearable, okay, when you listen to the people talk about it from down there. And they have to leave their homes, where the ones that's got some money can do that, but it's many of them that are poor, okay, so they're even poor. And you know, this is from the Creator, okay? Now all of the things that these scavengers that they shouldn't have been eating, now they definitely are not eating. The crabs, the lobsters, the clams, the shrimps, the oysters, okay? And many of the fish that they could eat, they can't eat anything from down there anymore, okay? The Red Lobster chain had to stop selling shrimp here totally about, I read that about 2 months ago. And many other restaurants and food chains, they don't get any of that from in that area anymore. All that's gone, okay? So this is more of the plague. Now, you have the people still running around, don't know what to do, listening to these same people spew out the same propaganda, the same lies, the same deception. And like I said, these people who were on the shore of Alabama and Louisiana about a month and a half, 2 months ago, they were standing there holding hands. All I saw was Caucasians on the, you know, the news show, holding hands, and they were praying, asking, as they say, God to come and help them, you know. But again, they're not stopping and considering that the God that they're praying to, the God of Christianity, because these were Christians, they're not stopping and considering if he is God, this idol that they pray to, which is one of the idols of Christianity, how did he allow it to get into this state in the first place? They've been going to church all their lives, okay? Their fathers and mothers were going to church. Their grandfathers and grandmothers were going to church. You understand? Dropping money in the till, singing hymns, going to the house of idol worship, they call the churches, the synagogues, okay? These are the Jewish people, the Edomites, okay? The Muslims going to the mosques, all right? They've been doing this for years. So if these things are correct, how did they come into this state in the first place? If these are really the way of the Creator, why did the Creator bring these tornadoes that have knocked down homes all through America, you know, through the South down there, and Missouri and Oklahoma and Tennessee? So on and so forth. Why did he bring the hurricanes? Why did he allow the Gulf, the oil to spill out? Some people have said they did it on purpose, but still, whatever man does, still, it comes from the Most High, because he directs everybody. Once a person decides in their heart what they want to do, then Yah takes over and directs them. Go to Jeremiah chapter 17, okay? The heart is desperately wicked. Who can know it? You know, Yah said he tries the heart, the reins of the heart, to give everyone according to their ways. So when you come up with your desire, Yah takes that, you know, when one is determined to do whatever it is, Yah takes that and guides it. So now, how did this all come about if all these religions are correct? Or if one of them is correct? How did all these things come about? So they never stop to consider that, okay? So maybe they're considering it now. So now, you have these people spewing out, like I said, your Glenn Becks, your Limbaugh, your Rush Limbaughs, your Pat Robertsons, your Farrakhans and Sharptons and Jesse Jacksons. And they are sent out to the people, as all the rest of them are, to direct the people, okay, to shepherd the people in the way that the Leviathan, okay, chapter 27 Isaiah, again, that's the Illuminati, Amalekite, Edomite international banker, headed by the house of Rothschild, sends them out to feed the people the lies and the deception, to shepherd them, to prod them in the direction they always want them to go. Okay. Now, here on June 26th in Atlanta, they sent out Farrakhan, Louis Farrakhan, and his message was he was going to tell who the true children of Israel are. And this is vital, okay, because according to this book of remembrance, this so-called Old Testament, Yah of hosts made a promise to all the people of the earth, okay, to raise up this movement out of the children of Israel that would come from the children of Israel, through the children of Israel, shall I say, and it would come from Yah of hosts, and this movement would be salvation for any and everybody on the earth that sought the true and living Creator, that sought salvation from up under this demonic, satanic, oppressive system that overspreads the earth. Okay? For anybody that seeks peace, for anybody that seeks truth, for anybody that seeks righteousness or equity. Okay? And Yah made this promise, and he's in the process, okay, of setting up his kingdom, like it says in Daniel chapter 2, verse 43-44. He's setting up his kingdom as we speak. He has brought forth his arm, Yah righteousness, to the people of the earth to bring forth his light. So now the Leviathan, the great snake, has sent out one of its cockatrites, okay, as it sends out many. Okay, like I said, some knowingly, most unknowingly, that they work for the great snake, to bring this message of who the true children of Israel are. Now, I don't know how many of you saw that message, but I think it's on internet. I'm pretty sure it's on internet. You know, we saw it here in Chicago because they had it almost immediately on his Louis Farrakhan show that he shows here every Monday in Chicago. Okay, which generally is not what they do. They usually show old shows, but they want everybody to see this show. And that's why it came on very quick. Okay? But when you listen to what he says, and he's supposed to be a scholar of this book of remembrance. He's supposed to be a scholar of the Bible and the Quran. I don't know about the Quran, but that's idolatry, as is the New Testament. So I don't deal with those two things. But when it comes to this book of remembrance, the so-called Old Testament, then I'm going to take issue with any and everybody that comes up with any kind of spin, okay, other than what is the truth of this book. Now, in his so-called lecture, he said about, he mentioned, you know, about Moses and how Moses was sent to the children of Israel in Egypt. And once he spoke to Pharaoh, you know, he talks about how the people, the elders of Israel, rose up against him. Well, you can go to chapter 5 of the book of Exodus and read about that. And it was the Hebrew taskmasters, the Hebrew Israelite taskmasters, that were working for Pharaoh. Okay? Just like you've got these Farrakhans and Sharptons and Jacksons, okay, Pat Robertsons that I've just mentioned, Rush Limbaughs, Glenn Becks, okay, and many, many others, like I said, some knowingly, some unknowingly, that are working for Pharaoh today, okay, which again are these international Illuminati, Edomite, Amalekite bankers, all right? And after Moses and Aaron went in there and said, "Thus saith Yah," to Amenophis II, and then, you know, told him everything that Yah told him to tell him, then Pharaoh sent his men out to attack the Hebrew taskmasters or shepherds that he had set in place to guide the people in the direction that he wanted them to go. And they put a whipping on them. You can go to there to Exodus chapter 5 and read about that. And then they came in to Pharaoh and asked him, why did he do this? And he told him, he said, because you, in other words, you've been scheming on me. You can go in there and read it. You know, you're talking about you done sent this Moses and Aaron in here to tell me to let you go. I'm not letting you go. Okay? And in the process, again, as I've spoken of in the past, he made their burden harder because he told them to make brick without straw. Okay? And that's the same thing that the Leviathan, these Illuminati bankers, are telling the people today. Make brick without straw. Pay your bills. I'm not going to give you a job. Pay your mortgage. Pay your rent. Buy your food. Okay? Pay your car notes. Send your children to school, you know, to get lied to and deceived, but nevertheless, send them there. But I'm not going to give you a job to do it to. Okay? To do it with. The collapse, we're witnessing the collapse of the economy. The dollar is spiraling into inflation. Things are costing more, and we're going to see more of this when they bring in this Amero. Things are going to go up even higher. So this is like coming on again, the same thing that happened back then. Now, Moses had already been told by Yah what was going to happen before he even went there. Yah told him, said, he's not going to let the people go because I'm going to harden his heart, that I can multiply my signs upon Pharaoh and the Egyptians, that I can get myself a great name. Yah is doing this same thing now, okay? Because the Illuminati Edomite who rule this earth, okay? We've spoken of the UN in the past. We talked about the five nations of the UN, the only five that have veto power. And these Illuminati bankers control them all. China, America, Britain, France, and Russia. They control them all. We ran that down, okay? How they got in control of them and when they got in control of them. Okay? So they're running the UN, they're running the world, as it was prophesied in Genesis chapter 27. Now in Farrakhan's speech, when he got to talking about the birth of the two children, okay, Esau and Jacob, that Rebekah bore, the wife of Isaac, the son of Abraham, okay, the one that was to carry the vision, not Ishmael, the oldest, but Isaac, who was going to carry the vision of Yah, okay, and when these two boys were in Rebekah's womb, she thought she was going to have a miscarriage because she thought it was one son. All right? When you go into the book and read about that, you will see, was that Genesis chapter 25? You will see there that it was told her, okay, that it was two children within her womb. All right? And it was going to be out of character than what it, you know, the law of progenitorship was enforced then. And the eldest always was the ruler of the house, you know, after the father. But Yah was telling her he was going to do something different. The younger would rule over the elder. Now, if you listen to Farrakhan's speech on June 26th in Atlanta, he flip-flopped it and made Israel the older. Okay? He called it the black. Okay? There's that black again. All right, and he called the younger the brown. Okay, but he tells you that the younger became the white Jew. That's Esau. So he flip-flopped it. Follow me? And he's supposed to be a student of this book. All right, but it doesn't seem that way because he flip-flopped that. That's not how it reads in this book. All right, Jacob was the younger. Esau was the older. Okay, then he goes on to talk about how Jacob stole the blessing. Whereas if you read this book in Genesis, you will see, was it Genesis chapter 27? Because you read about the boy's birth in Genesis chapter 25. All right? And how Rebekah was told that it was two nations within her womb because they were struggling. And the essence of that is that these two boys were opposites. Each one was going to become a nation, and they were opposites of one another. And they're opposites to this day. Okay? And we've spoken on that in the past. Okay? Jacob, who spawned the children of Israel, all right, came out of him, the 12 boys, who became the nation of Israel. When they are serving Yah, the light of Yah is coming through them. Okay? Esau never did serve Yah. To this day, he has not served Yah. Okay? The people who have grasp of this book already know this. Those who desire to understand this, you have to go into this book and read it. Okay? But Esau has never served Yah to this day. That's why he sold his birthright for a pot of a bowl of red beans, some bread, and something to drink. And it tells you in this book he despised the birthright. Why? Because with the birthright comes responsibility and obligation. And that's to Yah. That's keeping this law. And Esau's never done that. Okay? Now, when you go to chapter 27 and read about how this blessing was given, okay, and how it was gotten by Jacob, again, this was just the fulfillment of what was told their mother before they were born. Okay? So Yah made this come about, because when you examine this, it was Yah that took the eyesight of Isaac. Okay? And why did he take the eyesight of Isaac? Because Isaac put himself before Yah, which he had already been told when Yah told Abram to bring Isaac up on the mountain and sacrifice him to him. And you can go in this book and read about that. Okay? On the way up to Mount Moriah, the mountain of Yah, Isaac asked his father, "Where's the sacrifice?" And Abram told Isaac, "Yah Yireh, he who creates shall provide." When he got him up there, he started tying him up. So Isaac knew he was the sacrifice. And according, you know, the way Esau's translated this book, because he's translated this book up through time, but it still came out, you know, Yah made it the way he wanted it to be. But you got to go to Yah again to get the understanding of it. This is talked about. Yah puts this formula forth, how one gets understanding or knowledge and wisdom, in the first 9 chapters of Proverbs. So if you read the first 9 chapters of Proverbs, it lays out the formula how anyone attains knowledge or understanding and wisdom. Because that comes from Yah. It doesn't come from any human being. Okay? And when Abraham got ready to kill Isaac, according to this book, it says that Yah stopped Abram and said, "Don't kill the boy, Abram, for now I know that you would withhold nothing from me." Well, we know that Yah didn't say that to Abram. He didn't say now he knew, because everything is before Yah. So he didn't say that. Okay? That's been tampered with. He didn't say now I know, because everything is before Yah. That's why we've got this book, Genesis through Malachi, the book of remembrance, that was written 2,500, 3,500 years ago, and it's still not fulfilled, because everything is before Yah. So that's not what he said. What he said was, now Isaac knows that you don't put anything before me. Okay? Just like they tampered with that first commandment, thou shalt have no gods before me. You can see that over in Deuteronomy chapter 4 and also in Exodus. What is it, like 20th chapter? 19th chapter? You can see there that they tampered with that, because the first commandment is, thou shalt have no gods before me. The first commandment was, thou shalt have nothing before me. Okay? Because Yah always should be put first, that he can guide you and direct your path and establish the way before you. And how do you put Yah first? By reading this law, studying it, these laws and statutes and ordinances, just like he told us in the last prophet before today in Malachi chapter 4. Remember the law that I gave to you by the hand of my servant Moses, with the statutes and the judgments. Remember that. Why? Because like Moses told our forefathers, the children of Israel, in chapter 30 Deuteronomy, at the end when you read it, what did he say? This is not a vain or worthless thing unto you, O Israel. This is your life. And by this thing you shall be preserved. You shall prosper. Your days shall be prolonged upon this earth, upon this land, that Yah thy strong one giveth thee. Okay? And this is the law, not only for Israel, it's for everybody on the earth. And if people get in harmony with it, then they will be in harmony with Yah, and they will start to be blessed. Simple as that. Okay? But again, the Leviathan, these Illuminati Edomites, don't want you to understand that. So they send out, you understand, the serpent, okay, sends out the cockatrice, the vipers, okay, to feed you lies and deception. Now, when you go over here to chapter 59, Isaiah, and I'm going to read this verbatim, okay? Now, what does it say? It says, "Behold, Yah's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, neither is ear heavy that it cannot hear, but your iniquities are separated between you and your strong one, your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear." Okay? For your hands are defiled with blood, your fingers with iniquity, your lips have spoken lies, and your tongue hath muttered perverseness. None calls for justice, nor any pleads for truth. They trust in vanity and speak lies. They conceive mischief and bring forth iniquity. They hatch cockatrice eggs and weave the spider's web. He that eats of their eggs dies, and that which is crushed breaks out into a viper. Now, again, when you go to these schools, you go to these churches, these mosques, these temples of these religions, okay, you're doing what? You're being fed lies and deception. You're being fed the serpent eggs, lies and deception. You eat this, you digest it when you learn it, when you read it and study these lies and deception. Just like I told you about Columbus, supposedly has discovered America and it was people here. It's like I just told you about Alexander, you understand? They tell you he died of a fever, but he was poisoned, he was murdered. Okay, these lies and deception are pervasive, nonstop. We're under attack 24/7, just like I mentioned about the soy. They had how they put out the propaganda, how it's so good for you, how the people in the East over in China and Korea, okay, in Japan, how they eat all this soy. They don't eat that soy like that, that's a lie. Like I said, get that Dr. Whitaker's book. He tells you about that. He lived over there. He knows about their diet. The soy they ate was fermented. But this is the lies and the spin they put on the people here in Europe, in any place they can put it on the people, right? To control them, okay? To destroy them, to use them. And when they don't have any need for you, they throw you away like a old rag, okay? Look at the NAFTA. Look at the CAFTA, okay? Just moved all of the corporations out of here, right? And the people here, they don't care anything about. Look at all these people that's unemployed. It makes no difference what the pigmentation of your skin is. You're unemployed. You're displaced. You're foreclosed on. Now, I mean, that should be very apparent, right? But they feed you these lies and deception. And you eat them. And you digest them. And then the only thoughts that can come through you out of your heart and out of your mind is some more lies and deception, predicated on lies and deception. Think in terms of a navigator who's navigating a path. They've got all the navigational instruments. If they make one mistake, one error, they're not going to end up where they are trying to get to. You understand? And that's the whole purpose in feeding people lies and deception, shaping their minds, molding their minds. That's why Yah said in Daniel chapter 2, when you read it, we put on the front of the fly we sent out, okay, that stone cut out without hands, without hands. Because like I said in the very first show that we did, the only one we've ever done in the studio, no educational facility on this planet that you can go to and learn this other than Yah righteousness, okay? And you've got to go to Yah righteousness for him to give you this kind of knowledge, this kind of understanding. Look at it logically, okay? Look at it logically, all right? Now, again, Isaac didn't understand. He put himself before Yah. That's why he told you know, Esau he couldn't go hunting. So he depended on Esau. That's why he loved Esau. It tells you that in the book, because Esau ate of his venison. See, Isaac was like a crackhead, an alcoholic, okay, a sugar junkie, a sex fiend. He was hooked on this savory meat, okay? So now Esau played him. Esau sold his birthright because, again, he doesn't care anything about responsibility and obligation, keeping rules and regulations. Isn't that the pervasive spirit in the world today? People want to do whatever they want to do. Esau tells them what? Liberty, freedom, democracy, demos crassi. Huh? Lies and deception. Okay? Because the people who have all the wealth, the people who control the Army, the Air Force, Navy, and the Marines, they're the ones who govern by force. And this is spoken of in Daniel chapter 11, verse 38. Right? What does it say? In his stronghold, he worships the God of forces, weaponry, okay? So now, Esau, what did he do? He sold his birthright, but he wanted the blessing, like most folks. They don't want to work to earn it, okay? That's why the lotteries are so big. That's why casinos are so big, Okay? They just want the blessing. They don't want to do the work. All right? So now, what did Esau do? He played his father. He went out a few times. He came back. Isaac said, "Did you get that savory meat that my soul loves, my son?" He said, "No, father, I didn't see anything today. Or the wind blew my arrow off." And he wore Isaac down just like a junkie. You understand? And when the junkie, whatever the junkie is, when he doesn't get his fix, he or she doesn't get their fix that they're craving for, they get to the point that, what did Isaac say to him finally? "My son, go out there and get me that savory meat that my soul loves, huh? That I may bless you before what? Before I die, I got to have it." You understand? You got to get me my fix, man. And when he said that to Esau, then Esau understood. Now I got it. Okay? But Rebekah heard it. She heard it. And she knew how this was supposed to go. As it tells you over, you know, when the boys were born. Is that chapter 25, Genesis? She knew that the younger, because she'd been watching the boys. And she knew Esau didn't care anything about Yah, keeping Yah's vision, his rules and regulations. But Jacob did. Okay? So she called Jacob and sent him in there dressed like Esau with his garments on him. She made the savory meat from two kids that Jacob got from the pen and dressed them and fixed them and prepared it and sent him in there. And he got the blessing. That's why Yah took Isaac's eyesight. Because if he could see, ain't no way Jacob could have got the blessing, right? Okay? Now, what did Farrakhan mention? He mentioned about how this name Israel came about on Jacob. And he had that all screwed up because the enemy has written out a script for him to read to the people. Why? Because the enemy listens in on these phones. And we know without a doubt that he's got Yah Righteousness phone tap. And he's heard how it's been explained to the callers and many of you out here who call here from all around the country and outside the country. We've explained to you how this name Israel came about and why. And Esau heard it. So he put it in the script that he put into the hand of one of his vipers, his cockatrice, to send him out to the people. Because make no mistake about it, these Illuminati Edomites fear Yah with the greatest fear. That's their greatest fear. That's why they've done all they could to try to steer people away from Yah. Took his name out of this book of remembrance, Genesis through Malachi. They wrote the New Testament. Okay, they might have written Islam. I don't know about that, but still they perpetuated it. Okay, and any other religion. As long as it'll take you away from Yah. That's why they've taken control of the educational systems. They don't even mention the term God anymore. Even though that's an erroneous term, still they don't even allow that to be mentioned in schools anymore. But when I was little, they used to. But they stopped all of that. That's how much they fear Yah. Now, when Yah told Yaakov to return to the land of Canaan, to his father's house, to the land of Canaan, Yaakov went to his two wives and said, "Yah's come to me, told me to leave, I'm going to leave." Because he still had about another year to go to be with his uncle who had deceived him. You know, and if you read the story, and you can go in there and read it, you'll see, you know, chapter 30, 31, 32, you know, Genesis, well, 28, 29, 30, 31. You read and see what his uncle did to him, okay? But I got to cut to the chase because we're in the time constraints. But like I said, we're going to do a part two. But anyway, he went to his wife and said, "Yah has told me to leave." So he said, "What you going to do?" And they like, "Hey, you know, it's no more substance in our father's house." It had nothing to do with love, emotion. They said, "There's no more substance in our father's house." In other words, our father is broke. He doesn't have any money. You got all the money, we going with you. Because we got to be taken care of. These children got to be taken care of. So they packed up and left. All right? Now, if any of you want to read it, you can go in there and read the situation with Laban if you haven't already read it. But when you get to chapter 32, Genesis, and they got near the land of Canaan, Jacob sent messengers to Esau, his brother, to tell him he was coming. And when they returned, he said, "Did you see my brother Esau?" And they said, "Yeah." He said, "He's coming, and he got 400 men with him." And Jacob was messed up, okay? He was messed up because you, as you read chapter 32, Genesis, he says to Yah, he says, I fear Esau. Okay? I fear him, lest he come and kill up the whole, you know, my whole family, all my wives, my children, everybody. You understand? I fear him. So he feared Esau. He feared flesh. And that was his problem, because his faith was shaken. See, we only supposed to fear Yah. Yah says in this book, make me your fear, make me your dread. Okay? Why should you fear man? Okay? Who should be made as grass? What's that? The 51 Isaiah? Okay? 49 Isaiah? Let me just make sure so I can put you right on it. Right. 51 Isaiah. Read that chapter. Okay? I just read this one verse. Verse 13 in the 51st chapter of Isaiah. Matter of fact, I'll read started at verse 12. I even I am he that comforts you. Who art thou that thou should be afraid of a man that shall die, or the son of man which shall be made as grass, and forget Yah thy maker that has stretched forth the heavens and laid the foundations of the earth, and has feared continually every day because of the fury of the oppressor, as if he were ready to destroy. And where is the fury of the oppressor? Okay, the captive exile hastens that he may be loose, that he should not die in the pit, nor that his bread should fail. But I am Yah, that strong one that divides the sea, whose waves roar. Yah of hosts is his name, he who creates host. Okay, so now Jacob was afraid of Esau. You can go in there to chapter 32 Genesis and read that. And he feared Esau. His faith was shaken in Yah. And he says, but Yah, you told me to return. But I fear Esau. So he set his family into two different bands and set them apart and sent them in two different directions. Away from him. He fell behind. And then that night, and you got to understand, as I've always said, this book has been tampered with, okay? And Esau has tampered with this spot. But this is what happened. And you go in there and listen to me, and then you go in there and read it. And pray Yah will illuminate you when you read it, after you hear this. Yah dropped an angel on Yaakov. This angel looked like a man, like the angels do. You can see that in regards to Samson. You can see that in regards to Genesis chapter 19, when the two angels went towards Sodom and Gomorrah. When they got up in there, the homosexuals thought, okay, that these was men. Because they see out of carnal eyes, not out of spiritual eyes, with a spiritual spirit on them, okay? You see this with in Daniel over in chapter 12. And various other spots. He looked like men. So this angel was dropped on Jacob. He's wrestling with this angel. Okay? He looks like a man. He thinks he's a man. He's wrestling. And then the angel reaches down to the hollow of his thigh. Not his hip, like Farrakhan says in his speech. His thigh. And he put a kung fu move on his thigh. And his hamstring rolled up. You've seen these athletes, when the hamstring messes up, they can't run. They're in pain. And this is the way Yaakov was. And then this man, who was an angel, who he's wrestling with, started to overpower him. And then what did Yaakov do? He hollered out, Yah, help me. And that's when the angel told him, now you are back on track, Yaakov. Don't you ever forget who your help is. And to make sure that you never forget that Yah is your help, when you have faith in him, faith, when you trust in him, when you are in obedience to him, to make sure you never forget who your strength and your shield is, from now on your name is going to be Yisrael. For as a prince, you have power when you are with the strong one. And it's only one, and that's Yah of hosts. Okay? And you have power over men. That's why that name, Yisrael, has been put on the children of Yisrael. To remind us, just like this fringe, okay, and this ribbon of blue, okay? Numbers chapter 15, verse 38, to remind us always when we hear that name, Yisrael, that as long as we are with Yah,
of hosts, he who creates the strong one. He is our strength. He is our shield. He is our salvation. And not only for the children of Israel, but for any and all of mankind. It has nothing to do with your pigmentation. Nothing to do with your pigmentation. This is not a black and white issue, as I've said in the past. This is a wrong and right issue. And Yah has made it for all people. And you can see this in chapter 56, Isaiah. His house of prayer is going to be a house of prayer for all people. If you learn to love the name of Yah and choose the things that please him, he will give you a place in his house of prayer. 56, Isaiah. You can also read about it. Second chapter, Isaiah. Fourth chapter, Micah. Okay? So, this is the, for Yah righteousness, Jerusalem and the Holy Seed. Peace, audience. Yah bless. For Yah righteousness, Jerusalem and the Holy Seed. Peace, audience. Yah bless.